Would you lift up your hands and your voices, and would you ask God that, Lord, would you clear out my hearing, amen, my mind waves, that I can hear from your Spirit tonight, God. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you, Lord God, for the privilege to be here. I thank you for this church. I thank you for its leadership. I thank you for the Portmans and the Schumachers. And I thank you for everyone else that helps and leads in this body. But I thank you, God, for the vision that you have given this pastor. And I thank God for the vision, amen, that you have given the church worldwide. And I pray, God, tonight, God, that you would work through us and help us and to be the people that you have called us to be, and we'll thank you and give you all the glory and the honor and the praise. And everybody said in Jesus' name, everybody said in Jesus' name, amen. All you people on this side, point your finger over to this side. All you people on this side, point your finger to that side. And now say to each other, your vision is essential. God bless you. You may be seated. Since the first quarter of the year of 2020, most of us have witnessed a new name tag, a new branding of sorts that has been placed on employees of particular places of employment. These employees have been labeled as essential. Essential workers. The definition of this word essential in this sense is of the utmost importance, basic, indispensable, necessary. And certainly, I believe all of us would applaud and appreciate those who fulfilled those important roles during the COVID pandemic. Amen. They might be here. Some of you might be here tonight. Would you just give them applause tonight for fulfilling their role, even in life-threatening situations? I mean, I was preaching here, and I went home with COVID. Thank God. Thank God for Apostolic Faith Church. You could have killed me. But I thank God for those essential workers. Even though it took a pandemic to bring the word and the meaning of essential to the forefront, it was very obvious that these now labeled essential were essential all along. Did you catch that? Matter of fact, there are many essentials in life that we many times just take for granted. Think about it. How many blind people do you know of that are actively serving in the army of this country? I don't say that to be critical of one's disability. I say that based on the practical fact that if you are going to serve an infantry unit that is taught to aim and fire a weapon and expect them to be accurate in their effort, then the vision of those soldiers is absolutely essential. Personally, I am thankful, I am grateful for my vision. Amen. I want you to know I see you better than the last time I saw was here. Just last month, I had two cataract surgeries. They took out my old natural lenses, and they've got me now with new lenses. I don't need glasses. I'm just wondering where those lenses were made. God help us if they were made in China, and right now in Beijing, somebody's looking at this whole congregation right now. On one occasion, Jesus was asked by a blind man, and Jesus asked the blind man what he was desiring of him. What would you have me to do? was the Lord's question. And the response that was returned was emphatic and immediate. Luke 18, Lord, that I may receive my sight. Brothers and sisters, and any guests here this evening, I believe every one of you in the sound of my voice value your vision. Hello? Can I get a witness here? Amen. You value your vision. I believe that each of you that has the ability to see would say that your vision is essential. The Apostle Paul in his writings equated our service for Christ as that of a soldier. He wrote to Timothy, his spiritual son in the gospel, and finding in 2 Timothy 2 and 3, he says, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Folks, I want you to understand something. As we get closer to the end time and the rapture of the church, which I don't think is that far off, but as we get closer and closer, things are not going to get easier and easier. We're going to have some things settled in our spirit. We're going to have some things settled in our faith belief. We have to know what we believe and why we believe it. We need to be able to look absolute fear in the face and realize that God is with us and that He is able to do anything that we can even imagine. Somebody say amen. Have hardness as a good soldier. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. If you've been chosen by God to be a soldier in this church, would you please stand and would you symbolize the thanksgiving to God by giving him a word of praise? Amen. I thank you, God, for the privilege to be a soldier of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Now, I did that because my watch also tells me when to stand up. Time to stand. When Paul wrote to the church in Ephesus, he instructed all of us that are in the body of Christ to put on the whole armor of God. That same instructional teaching then includes you and I right now in the present. All who claim to be followers of Jesus Christ are to put on the whole, everybody say whole, armor of God, so that we are to stand against the wiles of the devil. Church, you and I know that what we are witnessing right now all over this globe is corresponding with what we are reading in Scripture about the last days. Amen? Paul explains in Ephesians 6, he said, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, he says, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. I don't know about you, but if this isn't the evil day, I don't know what more gross can it become. Amen. And I want us all to stand. Church, Paul describes that we are to have our loins girt about with truth. We're to put on the breastplate of righteousness. Our feet are to be shod with the gospel of peace. We are to don the helmet of salvation. We are to take the shield of faith and the sword of the Spirit. And all of these parts of spiritual armor are absolutely essential. We just don't pick and choose. We all like the helmet of salvation part. to help you and I stand in these last days. Church, truth will sire newborn again babies in Christ. Do you hear me? Truth. Righteousness is doing things the right way, pleasing to God. Showing awe of a powerful witness. The gospel lived and preached brings forth faith and peace. Salvation is our ever-present hope. Faith protects us, and the word cuts through all falsehoods. Brothers and sisters, these are all essential to all of us. The reason being, as Paul wrote to the Corinthian church, he said, lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. More than likely, I'm sure that you've all heard of the illustration of the proverbial frog basking in the lukewarm water in a pot on top of a stove, only to turn on the burner under the pot, and oh so slowly, only to find the frog never even attempting to leave his lethal environment until he is cooked. He's done for. Church, that is exactly the lukewarm spiritual atmosphere we are currently living in. Is this okay, pastors? We're living in a world that seemingly is falling apart at the seams. There are so many that are plainly spiritually depraved, and what we are reading about and witnessing is absolute craziness. Huh? I saw this little cartoon right before Christmas, and it was a little boy standing in front of Santa Claus, and he says, I identify as nice. Which tells my spirit that we are emphatically living in the last days. Church, we got to wake up about this fact. Say, well, Brother Putnam, they've been believing that ever since. That's right, they have. And rightfully so. And I don't have any ball here to tell you tonight that it's going to be in 2023 or 24 or 25 or 4,025. But I do know this, that you and I aren't living until we're 4,025. One way or the other. Hello? And we need to be standing against the wiles of the enemy and taking our part on guard during our period of time in this army. Amen. All of this seemingly is coming rapidly upon us. Have you noticed that? Right before our eyes. The people of the world are like the frog in the pot. Amen. For you and I right now, yes, at this very hour, our spiritual vision is absolutely essential. It's essential for our spiritual well-being. I'm telling you, church, vision works. It works for yourself. It works for your family. It works for your church. It'll work in your community. And without a vision, people are perishing every day. In the Old Testament, found in the book of 1 Samuel, God's people were being tormented and threatened by the Ammonites. The enemy of Israel had encamped about and surrounded the Israeli area of Jabesh-Gilead. It was serious. For those citizens were cut off from any type of commerce. They weren't allowed to dig oil. They weren't allowed to have coal. They weren't allowed. Oh, that's today. I didn't mean to. You understand what I'm saying? This is why we can't be blind. That wasn't in my notes, by the way. They were cut off from any kind of commerce. And I'm sure that their suppliers and their supplies were diminishing. They were being severed from human essentials. They were trapped. And if nothing happened to alleviate their situation, they would starve. They were in a desperate situation, the children of God, to the point that the men of Jabesh were willing to seek some sort of compromise, some sort of agreement of peace with Nahash, the leader of the Ammonites. It was well aware Nahash had the upper hand, and he knew it. And it was causing all of the discomforting, threatening turmoil. Matter of fact, Nahash, in response to their willingness of Jabesh to compromise, Nahash stated his terms for peace, 1 Samuel 11 and 2. You can read it for yourself. And Nahash the Ammonite answered them, "On this condition will I make a covenant with you, that I may thrust out all your right eyes and lay it for a reproach upon all Israel." Now, church, I ask you, do those terms seem sustainable to anyone here tonight? Huh? It's interesting in the scripture, even Jesus said, if your eye offends, what did he say? Pluck it out. You know, I've been living for God for almost 52 years now, and I've never seen that happen. Has anybody in here ever seen that happen? You know why? Because Jesus expects, if your eye is offending you, that by your own purpose is asking God to help you so that you don't have to pluck out your eye. I don't see any pile of eyeballs anyplace. I mean, the people of Jabesh were hungry. Their families were suffering. And for the sake of their families and their own well-being, they could have justified the sacrifice of their vision. After all, they could live with seeing out of just one eye. But stop and consider this, folks. Most soldiers of any army are more than likely right-handed. Matter of fact, the latest statistics, I looked it up, states that 90% of people are right-handed, which means that the vast majority of the fighting force of Jabesh would have fought with their swords in their right hands and carry a protective shield in their left. Their archers would more than likely have been right-handed. And now consider this. If they would choose to lose the vision of their right eye for the sake of compromise, to ease their suffering, then there would be absolutely disarray in their ability to fight. It would be awkward. It would be clumsy. Having just one eye would affect their balance and their aim. and even their depth perception would be hampered. Losing their vision to their right side would cause them to switch to their left hand and fighting with their swords and then use their right hand for holding their shield for protection. Again, they would have automatically weakened their chances for any type of future victory. The Ammonite leader, Nahash, gave them 7 days to think over his peace offer. Brothers and sisters, do any of you have any idea what the name Nahash means in Hebrew? I looked it up. The name Nahash means serpent. The scripture emphatically states, church, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty. Everybody say mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself above the knowledge of God and bringeth into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Church, in this hour in which you and I are living, that old serpent, the devil, is still offering these same terms to all that will give him an ear. Satan would like nothing better, Apostolic Faith Church, in 2023 than for our voluntary surrender. Satan is still after our vision. The devil would like nothing more, Pastor, than to stop or hinder our spiritual vision. Hey, I've been around a little while now. When you have a vision like he presented tonight, this first time I heard it was right before I got up here. I guarantee you, you know what? You're going to be facing some spiritual battles. Huh? The enemy's coming for your right eye. He's coming for your vision. Well, I don't want any fights with the devil. Oh, come on. You fight him every day? Hello? I know you've heard the story about having a big church service and all of a sudden the devil appeared in the church service and the whole church went out the door except for the preacher. The devil says, do you know who I am? He said, yes, sir. And you're not afraid of me? He said, no, sir. He said, why not? He said, because I've been living with your sister for the last 35 years. I want you to know that that has not been my case. Say that in jest, but what I'm saying is Satan is still after our vision. The devil would like nothing more than to stop or to hinder it and have us settle for just for the now. The same old, same old. I like that recommendation for this year that we don't have any just ordinary service. Hello? I hope I'm not boring you tonight. Because I got to tell you the truth. I know where this came from. God is situating you and positioning you so that you are going to be of more effect in this community than you ever have been. Amen. Somebody's got to believe that in here. Somebody's got to believe that in here. Because he would just like for us just to settle in and be kind of lauded into a spiritual sleep, a come see, come saw attitude. a spiritual stupor, being satisfied with just the present, and be completely spiritually blinded about our victories for tomorrow. Satan desires that we get discouraged and just quit fighting. How many of you like to fight? Do you do that often with that guy next to you? I feel a lot of liberty here tonight. We have to have some kind of a oomph spirit within us that's willing to fight the good fight of faith. Amen. And not take no as an answer. When the enemy says you can't, I know a God that says I can. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. You see, he just wants us to give up and just maintain. Slump back into a non-challenge maintenance ministry. Brothers and sisters, if he can get us confused, especially as our present society obviously is, if he can get us to doubt and allow unbelief to take over, if he can get us out of balance in our basic Christian walk, if he can get us quarreling and fighting amongst each other instead of being unified in the original cause of Christ, if he can get our spiritual focus blurred, hour after I had this left eye done, I put on my glasses that I've been wearing for years. And it was so blurry, I couldn't believe it. And I took them off, and the whole world looked brighter. You know what, church? God wants us to get rid of some of those devilish cataracts that we've been carrying around with us and allow God to do his spiritual surgery on our vision so that we can get behind our pastor, so that we can get behind the will of God, and that this church can go forward. I tell you, folks, if he can get our eyes, if the devil could get our eyes off of the field, the harvest field, then he knows that we can be easily defeated. Church, I ask you on this first day of this new year, if you are in the midst right now, if you personally are in the midst of a struggle in your own life, if you are in the midst of a struggle and you're entertaining thoughts about throwing in the towel, then you need to do what Jesus has counseled all of us to do in Revelation. He said, I counsel thee to buy of me gold that's tried in the fire. You know why we have struggles? Do you know why we have problems? Do you know why we have trials? It is not hurting us, folks. It is making us that we're tried in the fire. He said that thou mayest be rich. Do you realize that we're the richest people on the face of this globe? You may not have a lot of, quote unquote, the world's money in the bank, but I tell you, we got riches far beyond the crown jewels of England and every monarch. Why? Because we know the King of Kings. We know the Lord of Lords. We know that he owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. We know that we are in him and by him and through him, and his power is working through his church. And we need to get white raiment that thou mayest be clothed, that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear. But he doesn't stop there. And he says, and anoint thy eyes with eyesalve, that thou mayest see. Stand with me tonight. Church, please listen to me carefully as I close here. We've got to understand that our spiritual vision is essential. Now, I broadly have been talking about the vision of the church as a whole. Every husband in this room, every would-be husband in this room, listen up. You need to have a vision for your family. Boy, did it get quiet. Where are you going? What are you going to do? What are you going to have? What are you going to allow to possibly seep into your home? It's essential for your marriage. It's essential for the welfare of your children and your grandchildren. It's essential for your church family. It's essential for your community. Church, we need to make the same choice that the citizens of Jabesh Gilead made. They didn't give up their right eyes. They refused the enemy's offer and fought. And guess what? We have a giant killer on our side. Did you hear me? We've got a giant killer on our side. The Apostle Paul instructed Timothy, his son in the gospel. He said, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto you thou all also called and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. Be strong. Everybody say, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Just got to open our eyes. Elijah perched up on a hill, surrounded by those that wanted to take him captive. And Elijah says to Gehazi, his servant, you know, there's more with us than there are with them. I love it. Because so many times, just like that servant, he could look out over that valley and see, and he could start counting. There's more with us. I guarantee you, Brother Schumacher, you know this. But there was more than one angel out those doors. There's more than one angel in this room right now. And I'll tell you, if you'll lift up your voices and lift up your hands and open your heart, amen, God, amen, wants to renew your vision, to open the eyes like Elijah prayed for Gehazi. Open his eyes that he may see. Praise God. And I'll tell you, Elijah realized the essentiality of spiritual vision. Jesus, would you open our eyes tonight, God? Can you help us to see that thousand? Or God, could that thousand begin with just one that you would open our eyes to right now, God? You know, God, who our fellow workers are dealing with. You know our neighbors. You know our fellow students at school or in college. You know, dear Lord God, in the business world. You know. Open our eyes, God. Brothers and sisters, let's get a spiritual vision that overcomes our weaknesses. Stand strong in the power of God's might. I say again, Vision Works Church, lift up your eyes, lift up your hands, and lift up your voices right now. God is in the midst of us. He is on the throne, and He still intercedes for His people. Hallelujah! My son, just last night before he came to service, he talked with Brother Sergey in Kyiv, Ukraine. Brother Sergey had been praying for revival for years for the church in Ukraine, and especially the church in Kyiv. He said, Brother John, he said, last night my family could hear the missiles going over our home and hear the explosion. But he said, John, we are seeing things like we have never seen before spiritually. The church is packed to the gills. People are receiving the Holy Ghost like it's so many that we just can't even count them hardly. We're baptizing right and left. The church is full. Now, church, we all want revival, but I'm telling you, God knows exactly how to keep His own people safe. God knows exactly how to do it. That's why we need to get a vision that's far greater than ourselves and our own comfort. Would you sing it out to Him again? Hallelujah. That's the highest form of praise. God, give us a vision. Give us a vision, God. Hallelujah.